round every line.
You played right into his hands, Jack.
There's a truth.
I love you, Mum.
A touch of frost.
Where is he?
Sunday at 8, only on ITV.
You were indecently assaulted by Barbara Watkins in a Hastings guest house.
Kavanagh QC, Monday at 9 on ITV.
Tyne Teas and Sun Life, helping you plan for tomorrow.
Hello there, well, this is Coquet Island off the coast of Northumberland there. Looking a picture in today's sunshine, but by jinx, when you got outside, there was a wee bit of a nip in the air. And the reason we can see on the satellite picture here, 10 o'clock this morning, this blue line, it swung through the region last night. It gave some rain to most of us. And behind, you can see these white blobs here. These are rain showers, and they're into the west. Most of us today in the east have had a dry, sunny day, and it's a dry, bright evening for everywhere. There could be one or two showers up on the high Cheviots, up on the high Pennines, but most of us staying dry, and the cloud breaks as we go through the night. It's going to be a real cold old night. Those temperatures, I think, getting down to about 1 or 2 Celsius just about everywhere. Up at Powerbarn, 2 Celsius. Down near Hartlepool there, 2 Celsius. That's low enough for a touch of ground frost, but I think everywhere the roads are going to be dry come the morning time. Come the morning time, it's a nice bright start, but like today, I think we'll see 1 or 2 showers popping up. The clouds build up in the afternoon, especially in the west there, but most of us staying dry and bright. The temperatures tomorrow, well, they're going to hang in there about 10 Celsius again.
For a 7-day regional forecast, call the Tyne Tees Weatherline on 0336 405 440.
And now on Tyne Tees, North East Tonight with Mike Neville.
Hello, welcome to North East Tonight, this Thursday evening. In a moment, we'll bring you the day's main stories, and Pam Royle will be here with Prime Time, including our regular Out and About feature. Time out as the National Trust prepares for another busy season. Vicky Loughlin visits Wallington. Stormin Norman, the Jarrow pensioner who defied the infamous poll tax, still standing by his principles. And dig this, Nina Nurka goes green-fingered as she learns how her garden grows. Bob Johnson joins us for the latest weather prospects. And there's a full rundown on all the latest sports news with Simon O'Rourke. But first, 280 jobs are to go at one of the region's best-known engineering works. The redundancies will hit more than a quarter of the workforce at the former Parsons plant at Heaton in Newcastle. The plant, which makes turbines for power stations around the world, was taken over by Siemens 2 years ago. The company is putting the job losses down to too many turbine makers chasing too few orders.
When Siemens took over the Parsons plant in Heaton, it was heralded as a bright new future. It was a major relief following months of uncertainty as Rolls-Royce scoured the world for a buyer for the factory which in its heyday employed thousands of people. The workforce was already down to around 1,000, but there were promises of new job opportunities on the way. But at a press conference today, Siemens management said there are too many companies making the steam turbines in which Heaton specialises. 2 weeks ago, it was announced 80 staff would lose their jobs. Today, that figure was increased to 280. It leaves just 600 at this factory.
We have promised 1.5 years ago that we have an rising business here, especially in the service market. But the world is changing, and with the acquisition of Westinghouse and the pressure from the market, we have now the overcapacity, and we have to look into the future that even with a reduced workforce, we can keep this manufacturing unit running for the future.
Unions at the plant say they're bitterly disappointed. They say the workforce has achieved everything Siemens have asked of them. An enhanced redundancy package is on offer, but so far only 30 people have volunteered to take it.
A woman has been jailed for 70 days for criminal damage to a dog. Teesside magistrates were told that the terrier crossbreed died after she smacked it. 27-year-old Lynn McDonald pleaded guilty, but the court accepted a not guilty plea to ill-treating the animal.
The court was shown this picture of the year-old dog called Oliver. He was given on trial to Lynn McDonald for 2 weeks after being advertised. The magistrates in Middlesbrough were told she smacked him when he urinated back home after being taken for a walk, and he died. She lied that he'd run away when asked what had happened by his owner, but later admitted burying Oliver's body on land at Hemlington on the outskirts of Middlesbrough. Lynn McDonald had with her in court a small shoulder bag in the form of a Dalmatian dog. She stared straight ahead as the chairman of the bench, Mr. Mohammed Haji Shak, sentenced her to 70 days. He said it was an appalling act of cruelty, aggravated by the fact that she hid what happened to the dog.
What she did, I think, was a disgrace. The animal belonged to somebody else. It's just a gutless act what she's done. I'm just delighted that they're taking it so serious and she has got a custodial sentence.
Her solicitor lost an application for bail pending an appeal against the sentence.
More on those stories just before six, plus all the rest of the news from the northeast.
And from the summits of Nepal to the deepest sewerage shaft in Britain, Alan Hinks prepares in unconventional style to conquer the roof of the world.
In sport, the thunderclouds are gathering again. Gateshead are preparing for their first Super League road trip. For coach Sean McRae, it promises to be a special one. More on that, plus all the details from FA headquarters as Kevin Keegan names his first England squad.
All that in North East Tonight News just before six. But first, let's join Pam for Prime Time.
Hello. There have been some wonderful days for getting out in the fresh air lately, and Vicky Loughlin's been taking time out this week at one of our most beautiful, stately homes. With spring in the air, it seems at Wallington Hall in Northumberland.
Now, when it comes to gardening, we're not so much like this. Sort of like this, really. My idea of good gardening is you pull out all the things that look not so pretty and keep in all the pretty things, which means I've got a garden full of very pretty weeds. But could you imagine what it must be like trying to work and maintain a place this size?
Well, there's no way they'd let me get my hands on the gardens here at Wallington. It does take bags of TLC to maintain, and there's a lot of plants to talk to.
Now, John, you've been head gardener here for, what is it, 9 years?
Approaching that, yes.
How many people does it take to run an estate that is this big?
Well, five gardeners, quite a lot of other staff, obviously, about 17 in total. But we do get help from volunteers.
You don't just have to come and look around the gardens and the wonderful house. You do special events as well, don't you?
That's right. We have pop concerts and classical concerts, things like that, various children's shows. So we like to cater for all.
Now, like I said, you've been here for 9 years, so you must know all the ins and outs of some of the things that are just a bit bizarre.
Yes, well, Wallington's quite a fun place, I think. People do come and have fun, and on one occasion we actually had the Fast Show here.
Brilliant. Was it good fun?
It was indeed, yeah.
Yes, one way to see the place in a whole different light, I'd have thought.
That's right.
And there's some other things as well you were telling me about earlier. Should we go and have a look at those and explain a bit more? So, John, where do these come from?
Well, we believe they came from Bishopsgate in London. And they got here because of there's plenty of ships going to London with coal full. And, of course, they didn't want to come back empty. So these form the ballast to enable them to sail back.
They are amazing, and what's even more amazing is I'm sure one of them looks like my ex-boyfriend, you know. Now, this beautiful tree was planted in 1936 by a very special someone, the playwright George Bernard Shaw. Isn't it just amazing?
The gardens have hit the headlines quite a bit recently, but unfortunately it wasn't the herbaceous borders that stopped the press. The dreadful storms of last winter left the walled garden in ruins. They're doing their best to repair the place, but beauty doesn't come for free. So tomorrow night at 7:30, they're holding an auction of promises. Space is limited, so call ahead first to check. And John has offered his services as a gardener to the highest bidder, but he won't be getting his hands dirty for less than £100.
Now, these fabulous gardens are open all the year round, but if you fancy a quick roundup of all the other stuff that's on and about this weekend, take a look at this. What's a wonder in a way? Because my inside is outside, the right side's on the left side. There's a way to reach you now, but I might never reach you. Only want to teach you about you. But that's not you, but you know it's true. Well, that's all from me this week. I'll be back next Thursday. But if you're still brimming with energy and enthusiasm, don't forget to check out Judy McCourt tomorrow for a night out on the town.
She'll be chatting to latest teen sensation Christian Fry. Waking Ned is our movie of the week and...
Hi, I'm Roger Taylor. Join me tomorrow on the town with Judy McCourt.
You can contact me at Tyne Tees Television if you're holding an event you'd like me to feature on Time Out.
Thanks, Vicky. I know what I'll be doing this weekend. My little lad's five. Party time. Right now, though, time for a break. Coming up after that, Nina Nurka faces up to her fear of the garden. And never say die, Norman Laws, the pensioner jailed for the poll tax, still battling against officialdom.